This is Ethiopia. You know it. Ethiopia is looked at by the modern world with disgust. To the outside world, it is an impoverished, hungry, war-torn area, even though many people have barely heard of what goes on inside the nation. Yes, it does have poverty and famine, and currently, okay, it's in the middle of a civil war, but when you compare it to its past self or the perception that many Westerners have about Ethiopia, it is miles and kilometers ahead of how it sounds. After all, this is one of the most ancient regions on the planet and the only African region to survive European colonization, combined with the fact that Ethiopia has some of the highest growing economies and populations worldwide means the nation is rapidly improving. Ethiopia has survived for thousands of years without being conquered. Will that make it an ever more important African power? What is the future of Ethiopia? No nation can be talked about without looking up what makes the land. Sitting on the Horn of Africa, Ethiopia is mostly made up by the Ethiopian highlands. These mountains make up most of the interior of the country, and the edges provide a natural border for the western and southern sides. On the east side, though, is a more stereotyped Ethiopia: plains, savanna, and desert. Some of the highlands and plateau drop smoothly into the East Sudanian savanna, but much of it is a sharp escarpment, cliffs which separate the mountains from the desert. Now, in pretty much any other country on Earth, the way borders work is by having the mountains and rivers on the outside to protect the country, with the flat, farmable land on the inside to feed the population centers. Ethiopia flips this around. The flatter, easier to live in land are on the outskirts, with the mountainous, harder to live in land on the inside. But besides the expected invasion or two from the flat exterior, this is an excellent geography for keeping the Ethiopians thriving. Look at the satellite map of Ethiopia. The land, which rises about 2 kilometers off the ground, is much, much greener than the outskirts of the nation. In fact, it's a lot greener than the rest of East Africa too, and it all has to do with H2O. Many rivers of the region spawn in these highlands, flowing down to lower lands: the Awash, Shabelle, Juba, Baro, and oh yeah, the Nile River. You may have heard of that one. Lakes like Lake Abaya, Ziwe, and Tana also scatter the region's holy nature, filling up with pools of water. This has transformed Ethiopia's center into a green escape in the middle of the desert, and it's here where the ancient peoples of Ethiopia made their civilization. Look at the population density map of Ethiopia compared to its geography. Almost all Ethiopians live in the mountains. It's here where they can survive, drink water, farm food, make cities, culture, civilization, and as an added bonus, you can prevent invasions pretty easily when you live on top of a mountain. Maybe geography didn't let attacking be their strong suit, but the Ethiopians have defended for thousands of years. They ought to have it figured out by now. No one will be able to push them out of these mountains. Almost all major cities were built in the plateaus and valleys of the highlands, and it's exactly why the Ethiopians are an ancient, ancient group of people. They are defined by the cool green mountains, which literally save them from the rest of the region. But just how have the mountains saved the Ethiopians? Not all of what defines a group is made up of physical features. There has to be some history behind them, and there's a lot to cover since it's in these highlands where it's very likely that humans first evolved. Ever since advanced civilizations sprung up in Ethiopia, they have been independent from foreign rule. Almost all changes in Ethiopian society came from inside the mountains. It is honestly like a time capsule to the past, with the prehistory and ancient culture still alive there. The Demot rose and fell independently of the outside world, being replaced by the Aksum. It was here when Christianity was first introduced to the Ethiopians, becoming the second nation on earth to adopt it. It is preserved quite well in its original form as the Orthodox Tewa Haedo Church, and has remained the dominant religion for millennia. Eventually, though, the Aksum were replaced by the Zagwe in the Middle Ages. The Zagwe dynasty was then overthrown by the Solomonic dynasty, who rules from 1270 until the mid-70s. Oh, not mid-1270s, mid-1970s. The Solomons ended up controlling the Ethiopian Empire until its modern form, but in the 1500s they made contact with the Europeans, who turned out to be pretty important in a couple hundred years. And when those European empires entered into an age of expansion, Ethiopia entered one of isolation, known as the Zamene Mesefint, or the Age of Princes. the emperors almost had no control over the country, which was split up into multiple princedoms fighting for power. And when a nation is weak and decentralized, someone is going to try to take over. And who other than the British attempted to conquer the land, but a coalition formed against them, headed by Tewodros II. He modernized Ethiopia, creating a national army, restructured administration, and established sovereignty of the Ethiopian nation-state. Both Turkish and Egyptian forces invaded and failed to conquer Ethiopia, so they decided it was time to do a little conquering themselves. Under Menelik II, Ethiopia expanded physically, with only minor atrocities committed. He expanded infrastructure greatly, made a central taxation system, and created statewide education. This made Ethiopia one of, if not the most advanced nations in Africa at the time. And with all that, his greatest achievement was actually fighting off the Italians, who had previously been promised this slice of Africa to be scrambled. The Ethiopians ended up winning at the Battle of Adwa and signed a peace treaty with the Italians. They wouldn't come back until 40 years later when they got a little edgy and fascist, this time invading with machine guns, chemical weapons, and tanks. And yes, I lied, Ethiopia hadn't been independent ever since the classical age, but it only spent 5 years under Italian rule. More modernization under Haile Selassie, who was overthrown when gas prices got too high and Ethiopia had a little flirting with communism. The USSR helped them defeat the invading Somalis, who at the time were in a winning position to take a decent chunk of land. And after the fall of the Soviets, Ethiopia transitioned into a democratic, in theory, republic. Today, Ethiopia is still dealing with modernizing the country, improving infrastructure, food production, capital, as well as dealing with some of the ethnic tensions and a certain mega dam being built. Modernization efforts in the mountains have protected and advanced Ethiopia much ahead of Africa in the past. Why shouldn't the trend continue? Demographically, Ethiopia is in an interesting position. Its population pyramid is a literal pyramid, meaning the country of already 115 million people will boom in population, reaching 200 million by 2050 and around 300 million in 2100. Just 40 years ago, Ethiopia had a population of less than 40 million people. This new population means that around half of all Ethiopians are under 18 years old, which of course, when you're looking at the countries of the future, having a young population now means a middle-aged population in a couple decades, and a middle-aged population means a highly skilled, able population to grow the country. But, like all countries which have a massive surge in population, there will be some unrest. And like many African nations, that unrest will likely come in the form of ethnic tensions. Ethiopia is, after all, still a multi-ethnic, multilingual country. The largest ethnic group and language is the Oromo, making up about a third of the country. The second largest group is the Amhara, with their language Amharic, making up about a quarter of the country. The rest are smaller regional groups, none making up above 6% of the population. The Somali, the Tigray, Sidama, Guruje, and many, many others make up this portion. Over the course of millennia, many ethnic groups have been blurred by interracial marriage, especially in the core highlands. But outside, on the outskirts of the country, there are certainly distinct pockets of non-Oromo, non-Amharic people groups. Most in the south and west, but most notably the Tigray in the north and Somalis in the east. When the country inevitably has tension due to the rising population and industrialization, it's in these regions where the pain will go, while the central areas reap the rewards of a modern country. And the country has a long way to go until fully industrialized, with an urban population of just 20%. You will likely see more ethnic groups on the outside try to break off of Ethiopia in the future, at least until the center is rich. Then, of course, they'll beg to stay. But just when will that heart of Ethiopia get rich? After all, it isn't exactly that wealthy nowadays, ranking 63rd worldwide by GDP and 167th by GDP per capita. The country hopes, though, that it will grow tremendously. The population may cause some light unrest, but undoubtedly it'll bring jobs, education, and cold hard cash to the nation. Right now, the Ethiopian economy is fairly pre-industrialized. 85% of the labor force and 40% of the GDP works in material extraction, mainly in farming different vegetables, yet mining is a substantial business in the mountains. The other 15% of the labor force and bulk of the economy is working in industry and services. Industry like making textiles, clothing, and engine or aircraft manufacturing, and services like finance, telecommunications, and transportation. It is expected that these latter two will absolutely explode as the young population starts filling these jobs. Ethiopia is expected to become a manufacturing hub of Africa, and with the continent's population growing to 4 billion by 2100, the Ethiopians will certainly have a large market in their vicinity. If Lagos, Nigeria is trying to become a continent-wide financial hub, the New York City of a new Africa, Addis Ababa will be the Chicago, a manufacturing and transportation center of the continent. However, Ethiopia still has a long way to go before it is the African powerhouse, and Africa is a massive continent with soon to be billions of people. Why is Ethiopia going to be its power? Why not the 50 other nations? Why not nations which are already powerful nowadays, like Nigeria, Egypt, or South Africa? Well, to be honest, most of the 50 other nations shouldn't even exist. They were drawn up by the Europeans using straight lines and rulers, ignoring natural and ethnic boundaries. Ethiopia was the only major African power to survive this, and even if it were colonized for real, the mountainous core provides a physical territory the Ethiopians could have used to unite themselves. During the population growth of Africa, it's very likely many of these countries will collapse into smaller nations bounded by ethnic and geographical lines, which actually makes sense. Some important countries nowadays have a good chance too. Ethiopia's ethnic diversity is on its outer borders. Its future civil conflicts will be minor compared to some of the others African nations will experience. That's what the Tigray War is, a small uprising with no real chance of splitting off from the country. But even then, there will be new nations to rival Ethiopia, and many nations have a good chance of surviving too. How will Ethiopia face the other African nations? In its direct vicinity, there are weaker nations like Somalia. The Somali have caused quite a big geopolitical reaction compared to their size from their location directly along one of the busiest trade routes in the world, and their little anarchy which has caused a little piracy along that route. Almost every major world power wouldn't mind a strong East African power to keep the Somalis in check. In fact, Ethiopia used to own northern Eritrea, but it split off, taking the nation's coastline. If, in the future, Ethiopia were to take back Eritrea, the nations of the world might just look away, hoping for a stable naval power in the region. But there's one real power that might be in the way of Ethiopia's plans. If you go along the rivers of Ethiopia, and then go downstream, you'll find the flatlands of Egypt. Currently, Egypt is a regional power, and quite a strong nation at that, yet its future is looking a little weak and shaky. If Egypt wants to make itself an African power, it has to act within the next decade, either improving its country or through a classic war. But why would Egypt ever want to attack Ethiopia, especially in such a strong defensive position? It's all about electricity. Currently, 90% of Ethiopia's energy comes from hydroelectric dams, and their biggest and best one yet is the Grand Renaissance Dam on the Blue Nile. This will create a butt-ton of energy for the Ethiopians, allowing both urban and rural development to rocket. But as the dam fills, Egypt, as a country which relies so much on one water source, fears a loss of water and food production. And as already a not-so-stable nation, a small change in food production and prices could have catastrophic effects. Egypt does not want this dam. They have tried compromising, they have tried to stop construction of the dam, they have even suggested blowing it up.
And you can't blame Egypt for being a little bit upset, right? And it's a very dangerous situation because Egypt is not going to be able to live that way. And they'll end up blowing up the dam. And I said it, and I say it loud and clear, they'll blow up that dam.
To Ethiopia, building this dam might send them into a golden age of development. But to Egypt, building this dam would mean a death sentence. Tensions are rising in the region, and as one of Egypt's only times to act, it's getting likelier that the inevitable might happen. A war between these two countries would be one of the largest of the 21st century, and nobody wants to deal with that. Yet, if the war were to happen, even with Egypt's larger and more advanced army, Ethiopia is in such a good position that it is not going anywhere if it loses. If the 1900s were the American century and the 2000s are the Asian century, then the 2100s is certainly the African century. At the forefront of this new Africa will be Ethiopia, one of, if not the continent's powerhouse. With a core made out of the Ethiopian highlands, the country is one of the only African nations to have physical features that unite it together. And as the only African nation to survive European colonialism, it's one of the only African nations to actually make sense to exist. Its population and economy are growing rapidly every year, and Ethiopia hopes to use that to produce for Africa. There are no East African nations which can conquer it, meaning a fairly peaceful future for a continent which might soon have one of the bloodiest times in its history. The country of Ethiopia was created by its highlands, and it's these mountains which have also saved Ethiopia. It might have a few bumps along the way, but don't be surprised when Ethiopia becomes the African power. Since you watched the whole video, you probably enjoyed my content. Check out some of my other videos here, and don't forget to leave a like and subscribe. Thank you for watching.